call to order. Tonight's meeting of the Conservation Commission is being recorded for RCTV, Comcast Channel 22, or Verizon Channel 33. The videographer for tonight's meeting is Alexander, and you can check www.rctv.org for more information and for replay times. The first item on our agenda is under an existing permit 270-0568, Town Forest, Eagle Scout Project, Ben Benass. Mr. Benass?
I'm good.
Yeah, you can, I'm gonna have to flip it forward for you, so give me a signal.
So, I previously presented my project proposal to the Town Forest Committee and the Trails Committee, and they had both approved it, and they told me to present it to the Conservation Committee, so that's what I'm doing here tonight. This is my Eagle Scout project proposal. I'm doing screech owl boxes, and my name is Ben Finesse from Troop 728 Reading. My project proposal, I will build, install, and maintain 8 screech owl boxes in the Reading Town Forest and Bear Meadow Forest. Why I chose this idea? I originally wanted to make wood duck boxes, but Mr. Williams, some might know him, had suggested screech owl boxes because wood duck boxes had been done as a previous project. I also chose this project because I really like the bird, and I think it would be beneficial to the town forest. And also a rise in population of screech owls would mean a decrease in pests and vermin in the town. So my plan, I've included dimensions for the boxes that I would construct. My plan would be to secure proper approvals from the Conservation Committee, the Town Forest Committee, and the Trails Committee. Once I have done that, I would then construct the boxes with help from my troop, friends, and family. I would then install the boxes in various locations in the Town Forest and Bear Meadow Forest, where it is best for the owls, as recommended by Mr. Dave Williams and the Town Forest Committee and other committees. The project would span over 3 weekends of work, including construction and installation. And I would install the boxes in late August, as their nesting season is in mid-March to April. My plan continued. So the eastern screech owls are non-migratory, so they would often keep using these boxes as nesting sites for multiple years. And the boxes would be attached to trees about 8 to 15 feet high. And this was a previous problem in the other committees that I presented to, but the routine checks in order to repair and clean the boxes if necessary, that would only be done probably once or twice a year. Routine checks would not be consist like once every week, so that was a previous problem. The benefits of my project. I already had put this in a previous slide, but a rise in population of screech owls would also mean a decrease in the pests and vermin. Screech owls in the town forest may help encourage recreational use of the town forest and other forests in the area that I would put the boxes up in. And they would also provide a good reason to take walks, and people may even want to search for them on bird walks. I know that's what Mr. Williams told me. Oh, okay.
Do you want to go back?
No, that's fine. So I helped, with the help of Mr. Williams, I took these pictures of Bear Meadow and the town forest, and these were spots that he pointed out that would be ideal for the boxes to go up in. There's just some pictures there. I have more. There are more pictures of the bare metal forest. These are, again, more pictures. These are pictures of the town forest, where I would also put up the boxes. More pictures. And these are just the citations that I found my information from, the websites. And these are the image citations. So that's my proposal. Any questions?
Sure. I think it's a great idea. a couple of questions. I see barred owls during the day. Are the screech owls at night? Do they hunt during the night?
Yeah, they're nocturnal.
They're nocturnal. So when you do your routine maintenance, when do you expect to do that? Would they be in the boxes, and would you be disturbing them when you were doing that?
Yeah, that was a previous question from the other committees. They said that I would only clean them out if, like, say, like a squirrel started to nest in the boxes. So, like, I would obviously wouldn't clean them or, like, repair them when an actual owl was nesting inside of it. But if, like, oftentimes they'll get, like, infested with squirrels, so you would take out their nesting and then just wait for a screech owl to nest. That's basically what I meant by the maintenance.
Questions?
Yeah, and how much do you think it'll cost to make one?
I haven't figured out the costs yet, because I haven't filled out the packet yet, which I'm working on now. But between the wood and the screws, I wouldn't expect it to cost that much, because I'm not painting it either. Because as suggested by the other committees, you shouldn't paint them. They don't like the paint.
So I think everybody's a little worried about cleaning them out, not only disturbing the owls, but also for your safety. If you open that up and there's a squirrel in there, that might not be a fun surprise. So, you know, if they cost $15 to make, it might be better to say, I'm just not going to clean them out. If one of them gets wrecked, we'll put up a new one on a different tree. All
right.
So that would be my recommendation to think about. I think it's just a little bit safer. You're not dealing with whatever diseases might be in the box and anything like that. So you might want to think about that. And then the other thing is, we've talked in the past about, with bat boxes, putting them on posts to keep predators out from climbing up the tree and getting into the box. Did you guys look at that?
Yeah, so as suggested by Mr. Williams, he told me that putting them on posts and, like, trying to root them into the ground and would just probably be, like, extra work.
Yeah.
And that if you, like, screw or nail them to a tree, then it wouldn't be a problem, because screech owls are, like, predators, so they wouldn't get infested by squirrels or, like, other owls, probably. They're small enough. They're built for screech owls, I think.
And the screech owls, you don't want to mess with the screech owl, because they'll bite you. Okay. That was my questions. Thank you.
I have another question. When you go and do the maintenance on these boxes, how are you going to get up to 15 feet? Are you using a ladder?
Yeah, we would use a ladder. And in the packet, it would go over, like, safety procedures. I haven't filled that out yet, but there would be procedures done to ensure safety when using a ladder.
Yeah, I would strongly recommend you have a few people there holding the base of the ladder.
Yeah. And I just have a quick question. I know you had scouted out some locations between Town Forest and Bear Meadow. Do you know how many you would put in each one?
So I was thinking about putting three boxes near towards the entrance of Bear Meadow, over by, I think it's called the Matera Cabin.
Yeah.
And then I was going to put one in the field near there, too. And also I was going to put three near the entrance of the Town Forest, and then another one by the wood, the Town Forest area over by Wood End.
And you might want to also add that Mr. Williams helped you pick out all the spots and stuff,
yeah,
right?
Yeah,
you walked around with him.
I had a question, and it's similar to what they're saying. I think it's a great project. My question is, when sort of the maintenance of the boxes, how is that gonna kinda happen in perpetuity? Is that something that your PAC is gonna adopt? Or I'm just wondering if there's a thought of a strategy kinda moving forward, because I think it's a great idea, and I'm happy to hear that Mr. Williams is assisting with you on this, because he's a great resource. I'm sort of looking long-term, and I just sort of want to get a sense of how that's been worked out.
So, when I presented this to the Trails Committee and the Town Forest Committee, they also brought that up. They were saying, like, oh, you're not gonna, you know, maintain these boxes like when you're 50 or something like that. So, like, that's why they told me to probably change that in the proposal, because it's misleading. When I meant like checks, I meant for like repair if the box gets damaged, but obviously I can just put up a new one if they're cheap. Or like I said, if like a squirrel got in there and clean it out, but I don't think I would be able to routinely check them over a long period of time. But I mean, I don't know if my troop would be willing to do that, like keep on doing that. I would have to ask them, but I would probably eventually stop at some point.
Yeah, I don't expect you to be out there.
Back
you know,
college,
once a year,
first thing he's
going
to do is check the owl houses.
I'd love to have you so invested that you want to.
I like Mr. Harris's idea, I'm sorry, Mr. Curtis's idea of just taking that bullet out.
Right.
Yeah, I think you're doing a great thing here, and you don't need to, you got to be realistic about what you can do over the long term. And eight screech owl boxes in those two locations that's terrific. That's terrific. And I think what you can do is notify, you got the Trails Committee, they already know, so just let them know where the locations are.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you could make a couple extra and donate them so that if one goes bad and the Trails Committee or somebody else can help pull one up. But I wouldn't, you're kidding yourself to say, I have a 20-year-old son, and he's not doing what he said he was going to do last week, so. be realistic about what your plans are.
Thank you.
They eat mice, and you put one near my house, I'll maintain it for you.
Are there any questions from the public? Comments? Thank you.
I do.
Good luck.
To make a motion to accept it?
No, it's
part of
it's an existing permit.
Okay.
So I'm
under existing permit. All right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank
Great
you,
job,
Ben. Good job.
We have something quick that we can do, Chuck, because we've got a few more minutes.
We've
got six more minutes.
Is
that based on the revised agenda that I didn't print out?
Yeah.
No.
Because
7:10 continued.
Main Street continued. Did you folks know that Main Street?
We're going to talk to her.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
I always hate, people come in and feel so bad for them.
You can go through the minutes if you want.
Sure.
7:10 is not too bad, though. It's when it gets to 10 o'clock and they wait and then realize that.
Oh, yeah. Did you folks have an opportunity to look at the meeting minutes? There were two of them.
I gave Chuck my semicolon and comma changes.
I gave you the last, and did you take a look?
Those were my comments. That would put it out.
All right, what did I do with my last?
Not as good as the first.
Oh, these are, yours are in red.
Right.
Okay, good. What did I do with mine? Sure. What?
I thought 60 Main Street is continued, why are they here?
They just left.
Are they here?
Those two were the owners, and I think there was a.
The other woman was from the engineer, so.
Right. Right, and so they went out to talk, so they're fine.
So they're not gonna present tonight?
No, they continue to,
May 10th.
May 10th. You're Robert Hayes, right?
Bob.
Bob, I'd like to introduce our newest member, Bob Hayes, to the Conservation Commission.
Bob, nice to meet you, welcome.
Welcome.
Pleasure.
You're just appointed this week?
Yes.
And sworn in?
I was.
Awesome.
Duly.
Welcome aboard.
Now we can continue the conversation we started with the, Russ.
Maybe. Did you guys have an opportunity to look at the 3/22/17 meeting minutes?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm.
You're good?
Yeah, I've got no edits.
You had some, okay, and you, did you have any edits, what?
I put my edits in here, they are red, they're noted in red, so.
Those are, the red ones are hers.
Yep.
Yep, okay.
April 12th, and the 3/22, so, if you guys are approving both of them, just do it one at a time.
Right, do I have a motion to approve the meeting minutes for?
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes for March, what was the date, 22nd?
22.
22nd.
As amended?
As amended.
A second?
Second.
All those in favor? Abstained?
Well, I wasn't here for the.
Right, you abstain, you can abstain.
You can abstain.
Okay.
I make a motion to approve minutes April 12th, 2017, as amended.
Second.
All those in favor? Abstained? Okay.
It's 7:20.
No, it isn't.
Because we have videos.
It isn't, it's 7:18.
That's one?
Yes.
It's the joy of many clocks.
Are we ready to sign the roadway maintenance project?
If you'd like to, we can do that.
Might as well. They came in last meeting.
Yeah, we didn't, that was,
It was the multiple road work around the town.
Hmm.
That was the planing and milling, resurfacing.
Yep.
Pretty straightforward.
I thought we signed it last week.
It's 'cause we have so many site visits, it's just one weekend to the end.
I know, how many did you have, like, four, three?
3 hours. I had a meeting at 4:00, thank goodness you got 4:00, so I said, go there.
So did your kids have struck?
Yes, some does, came down with it Tuesday.
You got the white dots? No, do you have the white dots?
No, I just have the red throat, but, I wasn't actually testing, I just had some, so, I'm on it 24 hours now, so. Sure, everything's fine, keep my distance anyway.
Tell me about it. Yeah, it wasn't here.
Sorry, Bob, next time.
Next time.
It's a town permit, there'll be a lot more coming.
Yeah, don't feel slighted.
Yeah. See a lot more.
B, being 7:20, we have a continued notice of intent hearing for 70-0681, 14 Strawberry Hill Lane, map 7, lot 193, Moynihan. Hi.
Can you start?
Yep.
Okay. For the record, my name's Jack Sullivan, owner of the Sullivan Engineering Group, and we came before you a few weeks ago for a proposing ground pool to be constructed at the rear of 14 Strawberry Hill Lane. The existing house is under construction, and following that meeting, we were asked to try to come up with some landscape improvements, some enhancement plantings, to try to get this project to move forward. So I did make a few changes to the plan to refresh the commission's memory. The house was approved to be built in this footprint. In 2009, there was a limit of work line that ran about here. The owners who purchased this about a year ago, they're the third owner since some of the trees have been taken down in the rear yard. And I know some members of the commission went out for a site walk this week, could see the existing site conditions. What was good at the last hearing is the abutter to the rear had some pictures showing what it looked like pre-clearing, and you know, there were some trees, but there were probably only about six-inch trees at the most that were taken out. What we tried to do in trying to meet the existing order and conditions is the existing order called for about 2,700 square feet of wooded area to remain. It wasn't a restriction on the lot, it just, there was a finding saying there's about 2,900 square feet of wooded area to remain. What we've tried to do is I showed about 2,700 square feet of planting area to be provided on this property. And in order to work with the abutter to the rear, there'd be a 4-foot high retaining wall just off the rear property line. We're showing some evergreen tree plantings to be spaced about 10 feet on center to provide some sort of visual buffer to the abutter to the rear, and they're evergreen, so they'd stay green year round. And then we're showing a number of plantings. You can see I have a legend down at the bottom of my plan showing, you know, 16 Japanese hollies to be planted. The Leland cypresses, which are fast-growing evergreens, which would be constructed at the rear of the property, we're showing 10 of those. Additional hollies, 14, hydrangeas, 12, some green arborvitae, 3, and then some red maples, we're showing 5, and they'd be 3-inch caliper trees. We also made some changes to the in-ground pool. There used to be a patio that came off the back. That's been eliminated. It's a bluestone patio. And we tried to make, you know, tried to locate the pool as far away from the wetland area as possible. So we think we've done a good job here. Obviously it's going to be up for discussion tonight if you think this project can move forward. But I think the plantings that we're providing back, just the 5 red maples, that would probably equal what was taken out before in the back, and then we're going way beyond that with additional enhancement plantings. And we tried to line a number of the plantings up closest to the wetland area. The one area I didn't, you know, I have some right along here by the garage. I wanted to leave enough of a footpath between the garage and the rear of the property. There's a drain pipe that comes through here, and I wanted to leave them some ability to get to the front of the yard, to the back. But everywhere else you see in green is a proposed planting. So you can see we've done a good job trying to plant this site. Obviously, the new owners came into this. When they purchased the site, it looked the way that you saw it. They didn't take any trees down. They didn't do any of the work out back. They purchased it that way. We do understand there's an existing order of condition, and that's why we filed a new notice of intent for this project. That way we'd notice all the abutters. We didn't come in for a minor modification. It was a whole new application. And if the commission feels okay approving this, then there'd be an order issue under this, and then they can build this, and then we'd comply with that order moving forward.
Is there any lawn left?
Is there lawn, like between the pool and the?
There'll be lawn area right in here.
Okay.
And there'll be a little lawn area, or they could landscape in this area if they wanted lawn. But there's a small area of a lawn left for them.
Before you guys start asking questions, we did have a site visit, and I'd like to go over some of the observations we had at the site visit. It was Dave, Chuck, and myself. I don't know if anybody else got out there. But there's a, as you come down the lower side of the house, there's a silt fence and hay bales, and in several locations the hay bales are just like disintegrated. So we felt that, you know, if there are any significant rainstorms, you'd need to redo the hay bales, and the silt fence wasn't towed in, you know, as the bottom, as you put a little underneath the dirt. And we did see on the other side, this north side of the house, there are two drain pipes coming down, and it was hard to determine if that was on the property or not. It's not?
It is not. No, that is the neighbor's.
Oh, those are the neighbor's drain pipes?
Yes.
And there was some erosion that we could see at the end of those drain pipes.
I thought I had read something about those pipes running all the way to the, across the site.
Their drainage actually is that the driveway slopes forward and then into, is it a trench drain?
Yeah, right. I mean the ones, I know how the trench drain runs to the to the south side of the lot, but
right.
I thought I read somewhere where the, from the original subdivision plan, those pipes ran across your yard. Did they do that?
There's a sewage drain in the back where the neighbor's pipe was going to and where you saw the erosion. There's a sewage drain over there on that corner of the
lot. So it kind of runs into that drain?
From their property, the neighbor on the north side, it was running into a sewage pipe on the back.
I think you're right, Harry, though. I think way back when the subdivision was approved, there were roof drains, and they piped it across this lot.
Yeah.
So back in the day, that's what happened, but that's been eliminated since.
So that obviously would work when you tried to put a foundation in.
Right, it would have been, right.
And the existing drain, actually, we didn't see it. The guys who are building the house said it's right there. There's something on top of it. So
okay.
I assume that will be removed. there's an area. There's an area that kind of juts out along the south side, the back end of the house and the south side. See that little?
Closest
yeah.
to the resource area?
Yes, closest to the resource area. And it took us a while to figure out where that was, but there is a stake there, and it has a pretty good ground cover of ivy, some kind of an ivy, and there are some, I think, red maple saplings in there. But, you know, we were thinking perhaps that would be a nice opportunity to build up the habitat that, you know, we kind of lost when you clear, when the whole lot was clear cut, and to, you know, offer some kind of a buffer to that resource area that's off the property.
In this area here?
Yeah.
I agree with the sentiment that that 2,700 square feet not be spread out and distributed across the site, but I would prefer to see it put closer and contiguous with the wetland habitat.
There's not a lot of room, and there
and
are
there
saplings
isn't.
There.
No, yeah.
But I think
there isn't. But
so, Jack, there's a gap in this, right?
In here.
Yeah. What's that for?
Well,
that wasn't for the pipe.
There's a retaining wall, and I don't know if it's going to be built this way, but I had shown a retaining wall right here.
That's what that is.
And they ended up, because with the garage, you can only step the foundation when you get back about 24 feet on the garage. I think they stepped it, and they may not, so they may not need the wall.
May not be necessary.
So if they, that's why, you know, I didn't plant anything in this area because of the wall.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and I'm not sure what it looks like inside the 25-foot zone, if it's vegetated or not, but they could put some of the plantings in that area as well.
It's, like I said,
for.
It's that ivy ground cover, which is pretty thick, and then there are some saplings in there.
Yeah.
So you probably could plant some things around the saplings.
Well, I may jump in. Sorry to interrupt. I'm not opposed to denying the applicant the pool for the sake of keeping with the 2,700 square foot
requirement that has already been agreed to.
And that's what we try to do. I mean, we can do the plantings however you want us to. I spread them out only because I wanted to leave them a little bit of yard area, and I was able to get the 2,700 square feet to work with what I show here. And I tried to go heavy on this side here and here, closest, you know, to the wetland area. I think I came up with the best plan that I can come up with, to be fair. It doesn't leave that much area at all in the back.
Jack, just out of curiosity, what are you proposing on the top of the wall?
There'd be a 6 foot high fence, privacy fence.
No, the plantings.
Oh, over here?
Yeah.
Can you zoom in on that, Chuck?
Okay, yeah.
So the A is the arborvitae, these are hollies in this area. And that's why the evergreens that we're proposing at the base of the wall, they're fast growing evergreens. They add, like they say, 2 to 3 feet a year.
Mm-hmm.
And that was my idea. If the wall's 4 feet high and then you have a fence that's 6 feet high, I'd like to give some screening so that the neighbor's not just looking at a fence and at a wall.
The only thing on that is you might want to think about something. I know you want something to grow fast, but I have a pool and I can tell you as soon as the trees start getting to a certain height, you start wishing they would stop growing because your afternoon sun disappears.
Right.
And so you might want to think about something that won't get too tall there.
How large?
And they fast growing, but not tall.
Tops off at about 12 feet.
Well, it's 6 feet down from the...
Yeah,
I know.
And then the wall's 4, so that's 10.
How far do the Japanese holly and white holly get?
I think they only get 5 or 6 feet high.
I'm just wasn't sure how those root structures work, how large they get, because putting them at the top of the wall could be, you may start losing that wall after a certain amount of time.
Yeah, they don't have an extensive root system,
okay.
You know, so they're not going to push the wall out. And I kind of told the old owners, you know, a lot of times, as long as we show the number to be planted, if they wanted to do something in a slightly different configuration, they could, as long as the total quantity's there. But that's kind of what we came up with. They are talking with a landscaping company. Originally I had hydrangea in the back. They have dogs. I guess hydrangea can be cause illness to dogs, so we moved those. So we did have some discussion on the plantings, and they're non-invasive, and we thought it made sense.
Have I had the discussion with you about winterberry before? I think I have.
You don't like winterberry?
No.
Oh.
You need males.
Male and female.
Right.
Yeah.
To get the red berries.
Okay.
Like regular holly bushes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. We did have I think Van Norden.
I think you said that before.
Right, sorry. Dave, when you were out there, you had some conversation with the owners about the plantings on the other side of the wall?
I did. Because there are little trees that are on the other side of that wall, and if you look at didn't really see any setback from the lot line to the wall on the rear, on the western side there, lot right. And I didn't know whether that's what that area is. And most of those that are there are going to be basically planted in, well, right on the border of the neighbor's property. And that's what's going to form the border of their house. And one of the things that I did say to the Moynihans is that I know that the neighbor's backyard goes another maybe 20 feet or so along to the north, that perhaps they might discuss with them about carrying the same species along that 20 feet to provide a consistent landscaped barrier in the backyard, so that those 10 trees that you have there don't just stop at their lot corner, that they actually continue along the rear of their property line to their lot corner, which is probably, I looked at it, maybe it's 20 feet or so. So it might be just, it's a thing of like two more trees. And when I spoke with Mrs. Moynihan, she said that would be amenable to them. So that was just something that, one thing that I said, and I was there.
Yeah, I mean, here's the lot line right here, and
right.
I'm showing up. So are you talking adding one over here and one up here?
Right.
Yeah, so they'd be off their property. But if the other owner was okay with that,
right.
And the Moynihans
right.
are okay with it, I'm fine with right. They'd be fine doing two more.
Okay. Chuck, do you have any questions or comments?
The location of the trees, but I just wanted to just go over the pool itself.
Yep.
Is that does that need to be flushed out? Is it just contained? What kind of maintenance are we looking on that? Can you, and even if we close tonight, can I get a maintenance schedule
yep.
for that pool so
yep.
the owners know what to do?
Yeah, I thought we submitted something on that, but
okay.
But we can provide that. And you're doing a saltwater pool, right?
Yes.
Guys? So it's a saltwater system. There's no backwashing for this system. It's very environmentally friendly. That's why they actually picked it. But we can get you the maintenance requirements on it, but it's not like a typical pool with chlorine that requires backwashing or anything like that. I thought I had submitted that with the notice of intent, but if not, I'll provide it to Chuck.
The pool itself, like the saltwater pools, are actually run on cartridges. So when the season's over, you actually literally take out the containers because that's what has the salt that runs throughout. So nothing has to be drained out. Nothing has to be pumped out to the yard. It's all a matter of cartridges. So it's also economically friendly and good for the backyard as well.
So another observation is that there's a lot of tidying up with these two permits that we have to do. The work on the north side of the house, that was done by MBA Builders. I mean, their site guy filled in that area, probably added to those pipes, and with an agreement from the neighbor next door. So when they look for their certificate of compliance, I'm not going to start a whole new process with the neighbor. I'm going to ask that NBA take care of that, any erosion that's going to come out of there, and make sure that's planted. So, because I just don't want to, you know, get into these other things.
And just some of that work, Chuck, the 100-foot buffer zone's here.
Yeah.
So a lot of that work's outside the buffer.
I'll still ask for it, though.
Okay.
So, I don't know if this is a thought, but maybe we could get some more bigger trees in this area, maybe closer to kind of create habitat in that section. That's what I was thinking. I don't care so much about the other side of the property and how you spread it out. When you're out there and you're looking at this, you can visualize what's happening. I think it's an okay plan. I think that it works on this side, and if you could just add a little bit more in that corner, to me, I thought it might
sure.
might work.
Just like here, which corner? Because I think we were talking about this corner before. Because that's the closest to the
yeah. You
the
guys
buffer
talk
zone.
About that corner. I'm talking about
okay.
adding stuff right here.
So
mm-hmm. more, and then where are we here? And then we wanted some stuff in here before.
I
don't think you can put that many in there. I think
no,
it's going to be two or
right.
something like that.
There are saplings.
So maybe it's those two.
Isn't it true though that what? So that second part you mentioned, Chuck, is outside of the fence, right?
This here?
Yeah.
It's outside of a stone wall. It's not outside the property.
Yeah, there's a stone wall that runs along the property line. So this is a 25-foot no-touch zone, so we're talking about...
So where's the... I thought there was a chain-link fence.
No.
But you need a fence around the pool, right?
Oh. There's a proposed... There's no chain-link fence now.
No, I understand that.
Okay.
I'm sorry. So where's the fence going?
Show a fence. See, right here, we're showing proposed 4-foot high chain link.
Yeah.
And then they're going to they're gonna run that, I don't think I showed the continuation for some reason.
Oh, it goes further up.
Oh, it's right here, proposed 4 foot, proposed, and then it runs to this corner. So there'd be a gate right here.
So, I mean, it seems to me that, I don't know, can you, how do we feel about planting within the 25 foot? We're okay with that, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll put a couple of plants in there, and then I think because it's on the outside of the fence, it's gonna be good conditions for it to just sort of fill in on its own. And then I think that's also true for the neighbor's lot to the south. That corner there where it cuts in, I think is also gonna be
naturally
inclined to fill in, because there's nothing there today, right? It's just sort of...
No, it's there is. There's ivy and there are saplings
right.
in there.
So that should grow up.
It's there.
Yeah. Yeah.
But in that portion, that's where those big trees are. There's fairly big trees along
mm-hmm.
that
yeah.
part there, rocks.
Mm. Well,
I'm in favor of doing, you know, right now I look at this plan and, you know, the planting of the cypress and the winterberry and the holly and the arborvita are all, you know, when you look at the south boundary, I pulled out my scale, we're talking within 5 feet of the property boundary. And what the original notice of intent was talking about was basically, I'd say, half of that back wedge, the whole western half of that back wedge, to not be cut in the first place. Now that's in the past, I understand that. But that was a good treed area. It was providing some contiguous habitat for the wetlands to the south. And right now I look at this plan and the red maples, majority of the red maples, are out of the 100-foot zone, practically off the property to the northeast. And that doesn't make sense to me in terms of the conservation idea of establishing, you know, some sort of contiguous habitat and some sort of, you know, to retain that 2,700 square foot wooded area that was already approved.
I understand that, but I think when we saw the pictures that the abutter brought in, it really, I mean, everyone's saying it was wooded. There were probably 4 to 6 six-inch trees. They didn't go in and take out, I realize it was untouched and they did, it was touched, but it wasn't this heavily wooded area. And what we tried to do is like the number of plantings we're proposing seems.
I don't have a problem with the number.
Yeah,
I'm looking at the red maples and they're all along the northeast property boundary, practically out of the 100-foot zone.
Right.
You know, and those are the real cornerstone habitat builders. You know, so why are they about as far away from the wetland as you can get? As a matter of fact, you know, according to my my little handy engineer scale,
yeah.
they're within 2 feet of the property line. Well,
right.
I know what that's going to be. This is more a landscape plan than a habitat, you know, kind of
that's
restoration plan, you know.
That's fair.
You know,
it is a landscaping plan.
So
really
I don't see
a
conservation effort here, is what I'm saying.
And the red maples could easily come out and back. What we were trying to do in the back is the hollies are more of, they stay green, and we provide some buffer, and then the abutters' concerns. There's been concerns outside of conservation where the abutter says, now I'm looking at the back of the house, so we're trying to provide something.
Yeah, he spoke
being,
here, I remember
being a good
his
neighbor
comments.
And trying
yeah.
to say, we could put the wall right at the lot line. I said, let's put some plants to buffer it. So you're right, it is more of a landscape plan, but I really think those early pictures that we saw, it wasn't like this was a heavily wooded, protected area in the original plan.
According to the neighbor's pictures, there was some good, solid cover.
I tend to disagree with
yeah,
you. I
did
recall,
too.
Well,
I recall
from his backyard.
That was very sparsely
trees.
It was unkempt.
It wasn't natural, but it wasn't thick.
Viney.
Right. Those were all scraggly volunteer trees that were there.
Chuck. Maybe my memory's off.
I'm being generous saying there were six trees. There probably weren't.
No, I think in fairness, I mean, the whole thing was a forest at one point. It was covered with gigantic trees, so. Then over time.
We've lost, all those trees are gone.
Right, but here, this is the point.
I think some of those were on the original notice of intent.
At the limit of arc line, right here.
Right.
And then you can see, I mean, take a look here. So on the uphill side of the silt fence, there are some large trees, but those were approved to be removed. Look back here. I mean, that's one of the biggest trees right there. I mean, there's not much there.
Do you have an objection putting some more of the red maple?
No.
Towards, okay.
No.
So I don't think we have a disagreement.
No, I don't either.
So to try to put a bow on this, the corner there that's closest to the resource area, we put a couple of red maples in there. Would that do the trick?
And some in
some
the back
inside
of,
the yard.
Yeah, inside the fence.
Mexico.
So
Chuck, how do we, I'm still a little fuzzy on, yeah, I'm putting a bow on this because there's outstanding issues on the north side of that. We're MBL builders.
Right. So we can take care of those when they're trying to close out their order of
okay.
conditions.
All right.
And are you dealing with them also, Jack?
On other projects, so I talk to them.
But on this one here, or should I call them? That's what I'm, I mean, is it fair to talk to you about those things?
You should call
or
them.
Or call them,
you
okay.
call them.
So we'll have to call NBA and let them be aware that.
So that's the same thing with the, because the existing erosion controls are all part of their
yeah.
that notice of intent.
Yeah.
Any issues you saw at the site should be brought up, because that's on that existing notice of intent, not on what's being proposed here.
So we have all the questions from the commission members. Any comments, questions from the community? Okay, hearing none.
A motion to accept the or approve the notice of intent.
Did we?
We can close.
We've talked about it, but we didn't. We don't have where the plants are going, and at least I don't think we do.
Okay.
So I know that's what we're getting to, but I think we fell short of agreeing to an area, even if it's a line across. Plan. I think we need something.
I think we've got an idea on the page. I think we've got an agreement of where they can go. I'd like to see it on the plan. I don't think, you know, that will, in my opinion, I don't think that should stop us from starting to prepare the order in with preparation that we may close it, close and accept next week. I think we've got
2 weeks.
2 weeks, thank you. We don't. I think we're on the same page here, but I would like to see the updated plan.
What's changing other than the giant trees?
I don't see why we can't close the NOI and then draft a order of conditions predicated on what we just said about that, about adding the
so
number of trees.
We've gone through this before. Like, what's the harm of keeping the NOI open to see the final plan and just close it at the same time?
Just
as long as we're moving forward the order of conditions.
Because it's April and they want to put a pool in.
It's not going to get them any closer.
It doesn't change the timeline.
It doesn't change. Okay, as long as it doesn't change the timeline.
Like, I think we're in a position
you,
where we
but
can
then,
start.
And the other thing that it adds by not closing tonight, and Jack's not, usually not a problem, but let's say another site that they say they'll have stuff to us, and then it doesn't come in, and it'll come in the day before. We've closed. Now we're bound to accept. We can't do anything.
We're in this time crunch.
So if this puts... This puts the onus on Jack to
right.
deliver the plan and enough time for us to review it so we can close. And if he doesn't do that, we can just continue again.
Our normal process is we close, the order of conditions gets written for the next meeting.
Okay.
So
good.
We're
good.
Still on that same
Sold.
Time.
Sold.
I move we continue the notice of intent to the next meeting.
Do we hear a second?
A second.
All those in favor? Abstain or deny?
Oppose.
Oppose.
I
I just have one question to clarify. Do we want to see something in this 25-foot area, or we decide it's...
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, I think you can put a couple of red maples in there to Anika's point. That helps. Is that better?
Yeah. You have an indication of number?
Existing silt sock area.
Yep, I'm going to put some red maples in this area, and I'll show some plantings in this area.
It's not really going to need a lot, because there's a lot on the other side of the stone wall. So if you just add to that,
yep,
it'd be great.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you. Wait, thank you.
Thanks, Jeff.
Thank you very
thank
much.
You.
Thank you.
Okay, it's 7:30. We have a request for determination of applicability. 2017-1, Lot B, Zero Border Road, Map 6, Lot 4. No, that's been continued. I'm sorry. I apologize. We have a request for determination of applicability for 2017-4, 23 Tennyson Road, Map 33, Lot 165, Torchia. Mr. Torchia.
Actually, Jack was.
Okay.
He's your guy.
Jack will be in a few minutes, yeah.
Well, we had a site visit, and I guess we met with O'Neill Builders?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Right, and we observed. Did you see that site?
I know I didn't. I'm wondering if we should remind Jack.
I'm sure
you remember.
Well, I do. I have a question for him. We did see, I think, about five flags, blue flags.
Yes.
It was very generous blue flags. We thought they were up a little high on the upland side, but that's okay. And we did see a silt fence and the straw coil along the right-hand side of the shed, and Chuck asked for the coils to be staked in. And then to the left of the shed, there was three sections of silt fence, and that needed to be towed in. You know, this part stood on the grass. To protect the area in back, you actually have to put the bottom of that into the soil.
So tow in the silt fence.
He
said
was
he was
gonna
going
do
to
it.
Do it.
Oh, okay.
And I think it's already done. I didn't have a chance to check it.
Right. Yeah.
But it's the straw sock, and then on the other side of the fence, between your shed and the property line, it's that on the silt fence. There's a flap, and it's supposed to be trenched into the ground with dirt thrown on top of it, and. Said he was going to get right on it before we even drove out of the area. So, assuming it's going to be done.
Forest.
Question: do you happen to know if you're within the Aquifer Protection District?
I don't know.
I don't know either. I'm just Chuck. Is that on the GIS system?
It is, but every time I go to it, it.
I'll see if I can find
that
on my phone.
I've
got it up on my phone not too long ago.
That has to do, I don't know if you're familiar with this, but that has to do with impervious area cover restrictions per lot. Because it's a groundwater, a very specially zoned groundwater recharge area in town. And the reason lot coverage affects that is if all the rain hitting the impervious cover hits just our storm drains and goes 800 feet down the road somewhere else,
sure,
it's not recharging where it needs to recharge. So there's a
much of this
there's a lot coverage
proposal is a second story, and then in front street side there's a porch.
That's the only question I had was with that extension, that additional
porch.
I mean,
so
I know it's a little bit,
yeah,
but sometimes in some lots it really tips.
So they're
the
not
okay.
There was,
yeah,
I believe, going to be some crushed
okay
stone where the water was going to.
Yeah. Okay.
Further comments or questions? Any questions from the commission members?
give me the 1 minute spiel on what's going on? It's a proposed porch, roof porch on the front. that's really that's what's being proposed. I think it's pretty straightforward enough, but
yeah, I mean, the red mark there, yeah. So it was, yeah. I mean, it's a porch we're adding to the front as part of the project. And
here's your man.
Thanks, Steve. My wife just texted me, get back in there.
Welcome back.
Okay, I'll pick up. So on this project, and Steve may have already went through this, Jack Sullivan, Sullivan Engineering Group. They got a permit from Chuck to go vertical on this house, so it was a story and a half. They're making it a two-story house with no footprint change in the rear. At the front of the house, they're looking to do a farmer's porch with steps. When I met with Chuck on this, we thought it would be an RDA since we're so far away from the wetland in the rear. He did ask that I try to put some drainage in, so I put in a crushed stone trench along the side. So there'll be a gutter provided here on the porch that will discharge into this crushed stone area to promote recharge. And the porch is going to be constructed on sonotubes. It's not a full foundation. And the wetland line was pretty distinct. There's a pretty good grade drop at the back.
Who did your wetland delineation?
I did it in this case.
You thought?
Yeah. Usually I hire Norse Environmental. On this one, I did it.
You're very generous.
Oh, that, yeah. You can flag them all.
We'll take
well,
it.
Well, like in this area, you know, it looks like it looked like there might have been some fill at some point. I don't know. So I was generous with it. And it really didn't make a difference with what they were looking to do out front. So I did it in this case.
Where are your DEP data sheets?
I didn't do those. Not in on an RDA.
I don't have any further questions.
I don't either. Any
questions from the community? Hearing none, do I hear?
I make a motion for a negative determination.
I'll second.
All those in favor? Okay.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thanks,
thank
Jeff.
You.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks, Steve.
No, he approved. So
Bob, you approved or abstained?
He
approved.
He approved it. Okay. 7:50, and it's almost 8:00. We have an ANRAD 270 no number for parcel 0, Haverhill Street, map 57, lot 17, Gillis. And Mr. Gillis is here. And
is this a new lot?
Existing lot.
I'll get into that.
Yeah.
Okay. I was trying to find it on the town GIS, and I couldn't find it.
It's on the corner of
It doesn't have a street number to it.
Right, I was just...
Do you want to... It's from the board. Do you want to sound the 10 scale?
I only have one that's colored in.
Let me put it up in back of it then.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, whatever you want to do. It's just that the TV can't see that too well.
That's not too bad.
Actually, we would like him to introduce the project, and then we open it up to the community.
Okay, because I understand that this lot
was unbuilt
and has been since 1953.
We'll let the applicant talk, please. Thank you.
All right, good evening. I'd like to thank the commission for the opportunity to present. I'm Jip Corbin from Stamsky McNary. I'm here with the applicant, John Gillis. John is looking for tonight a determination as to the resource areas on this lot. To give a little history, this lot was created in 1950 as part of a two-lot division on Batchelder Road in B behind Batchelder Road, the rest of the subdivision was created soon after. The lot has been in single ownership since 1950 by the Crays. The Crays are the last name, Cray, the owners. And we believe the lot to be a legal building lot due to the fact that it predates the zoning regulations and legal in regards to use and dimensional requirements. The wetlands were delineated by BNC Associates in February, and just the other day with some members of the commission we did a site walk and adjusted some of the wetland flags out there. The resource area is bordering vegetated wetland, and just to the northwest is where the wetlands are. During the site walk, a flag was added off-site on the neighbor's property. Seen here is wetland flag 6. Hey Chuck, could we get the one I sent you, I guess?
10 scale?
Yeah.
Can I ask, do you have copies of this new wetland line?
That doesn't come in any better. Yes, I do.
You do? Because
yes.
I'm looking at the old one.
Okay. I have just a large scale. Would you like that?
Actually, this is fine for now.
Okay.
Sorry.
Let me get it a little bit bigger. No. If you look at that.
And as you'll see on the plan you have in front of you, the original delineation had from wetland flag 2 to 3. And during the site walk, there was a small swale observed within this area here. And new wetland flags were tied and located to create this finger. This wetland flag 2B, 2C, was set down here because this is all clearly upland, as reported by the David Crossman of BNC Associates in a letter that I have a copy as well with for the board today. So that's why we're here today.
What were the flags that were added, just so I can get them in the record?
We have wetland flag 2R, as 2 revised, was placed near wetland flag 1, and then wetland flag 2A, and above wetland flag 2A, 2B, to then back down to wetland flag 2C.
And 2 no longer exists? Is that
2
correct?
No longer exists, correct.
And then there's also, at the end, wetland flag 6. Right.
Correct, yes. There was a well observed that was clearly leaking and had a small depression associated with it as well.
Okay.
So a flag was tied up right near the well.
So we had a site visit on Monday, and Chuck and I had an auger trying to look at, you know, the test pits that were done by BNC, see if we could see the soil, hydric soil in the wetland area, and then the upland soil. Just to the north of or south of the upland pit, there's a lot of downed trees in that area, but there seemed to have been a depression that Chuck picked up further upland of that number 2 flag, and we asked BNC to take an auger there. And when we did that, there were some high color models, redoxymorphological features, and some very different color matrix, you know, within the the depth that you would look for soils, and so it appeared as though that was wetland. Now, we haven't gone back out. I understand you had gone out and taken a look at it.
So I got out, I must have been not very long after you guys had left, and the flags were up, and I think they were surveying them in, and I think I pretty much saw that the kind of the swale that you were looking at and kind of where it was following along.
Right.
It seemed to make sense short of any. I just went out and saw
yeah.
the result of what you guys did, but it seemed to make sense of where everything was going. I mean,
right.
Like,
and then the area to the north of the property line, there was definitely.
I didn't make it up there.
Yeah, no, there was definitely a pretty wet channel. And then we looked further, and there was a little opening, and it was a well.
Yes.
I'd like to just give a sense of scale for everyone. This northerly line is 195 feet. And the distance between wetland flag 2 and 2A and 2B is 3 feet. And that's the extent of the swale. Very clearly, upland vegetation on either side of that, as well as upland soils.
Does this require another look out there?
I mean, probably should, anyways. But I don't know if it. I don't know what else we're going to discover. I should just verify it.
Well, so can I ask a question? Because I think
yeah.
the only one that, in my mind, that really comes into question, you guys, I mean, it seemed pretty clear to me from the grades that were out there, but we had, we had, these are not ours, the ones you guys did. These
no,
are,
no, that,
these
those are BNCs.
Fits.
Yeah, so, but we've had a couple on either side of this direction, because the only flag that really comes into question is there something in between this area? It doesn't seem like from grading situation to me, but I was really kind of looking at the result of everything rather than.
It took a while.
So the original 2 to 3 area?
No, I went through today.
Oh.
Is that what you're talking about? The original from flag 2 to flag 3?
Well, what would be 2B to 3?
If you don't mind, I'd like to read the delineator's report.
Yeah.
So looking down the line at flag 3, we observed that the boundary would go up a gentle slope going up and throughout an area predominantly comprised of upland plants, including a about a 3-inch diameter birch tree in the area of test pit A1. Beech, excuse me. Thank you. We examined the soils along the side of the swale down to the wetlands along the stream. We found the same bright upland soils that were observed during the site walk. Based upon the soils and vegetation, and he describes the soils as well. Based upon the soils and vegetation, we hung wetland flag 2C near the bottom of the swale, where the vegetation was nearly 100% wetlands. Wetland flag 2C then connects to existing wetland flag 3. Based upon all of these findings, we now have a rather narrow swale of wetlands, which are further upgradient than originally delineated. This narrow area of wetlands is now based upon a much more precise delineation. And he also states the extent of the borings.
My only observation is the first plan we got, it was wetland. It was delineated as wetland when we went to review it, the flag between flag 2 and flag 3, which cuts across that area. And after further observation, apparently it's not. So that's
again,
why I wanted to check it.
This is maybe 20 feet between 2C and 3.
Mm-hmm.
Typically, there's not borings done every 3 feet.
No, just the first plan was passed in, and it was clear that it was across there, and you were satisfied with it. so.
Right, and upon further inspection, we noticed that that clearly is upland.
All right, well, that was my reason. It was just that we expected a flag to be at the top of the swale, but not.
Were we out there when were you guys out there when 2C was located?
No.
Well, then let's just go back out. And, I mean, I think it's pretty straightforward. I think it looks reasonable, but if.
I don't have a problem doing that. What do the other commission members feel like?
Where was the core that had the hydric soil that you saw?
Tip of the wetland spike.
Okay. Up from.
End of the finger.
Tip of the finger, okay.
May I ask, where is the town drain pipe on that map?
Excuse me?
Where is the town drain pipe on that map?
Oh, it's down there.
Chair, may I address?
Yeah,
this may be easier to see. There's a culvert right here running under Averill Street.
Under my house. Right.
Going mm-hmm. to near Wetland Flag 1.
I'm the only house on Averill Street that has a ready sewer pocket on it. No post going back out.
Okay. You know, I would pose this similar to what we did before. I think it's worth getting a something started to.
Right. Oh, yeah, we should.
But I think we need to. But I think we need
definitely.
To see it.
So, Jim, we would only ask that if we do go out and hang any flags, you could get us a plan prior to the next meeting.
Yeah.
And we would have the overhead ready.
Okay. Yes.
So I just want to make this very clear to neighbors. This application that we have before us tonight is to determine where the wetlands are or are not. What's between, what's a wetland, what's upland. That's all we are looking at. That's all we are asked to look at. So there's no development, there's no.
Determination of buildable.
Right, and we just, or whether it's a buildable lot or not, and that wouldn't be under our purview. I just want to make it clear to everyone.
Have you determined the wetlands that is behind my house, which the pipe?
This is not part of this application. No, we wouldn't.
So I'm sorry. Could you point out? Because I don't have a reference of where are you relative to.
Directly across the street.
Directly
on
across
under the culvert.
On Haverhill Street.
Right.
That would
Central
be
way.
to the southeast.
Southeast
side.
I'm sorry.
Of
what was your name?
Margaret Middleton.
Margaret.
And resident since 1957.
Okay. And so you live on Haverhill Street across
South.
Haverhill Street.
Yes, I do.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And that culvert, that pipe. Empties onto the back of my property. And as I said, there's also a running sewer cover on my property. And there's 30 feet behind my house, it's a swamp. It's a wetland. It's a conservation land. I just want to know how that's going to impact my land. Because the water that's there now that has rotted those trees, what, 100, 200 years old, falling down, that they're sopping up a lot of the water. What happens to that water?
Well, those questions would be for the next application. This is only for a line. There's no work being proposed.
Well, may I ask the thing that I got here? John Gillis. Who is John Gillis? And what is your?
I'm looking at. I submitted the application.
And what is your
Jackie,
she
can't talk to him.
She
has to talk to you,
please,
and then you.
Excuse
talk
me.
To
you ask me.
I'm sorry. I've been not there. This is my third time here on this. What is Mr. Gillis's? Participation. What is his job? Why is his name on the?
He's the applicant.
And what is his job, though? He's not the owner, so he's working on behalf of the owner.
I am looking at purchasing the property. I am in the process of purchasing the property. I needed to make sure that I could do something with the property.
And you're paying for that?
I am paying. This is all out of my pocket for this expense. The
Why
application.
Why isn't the owner paying for that?
Okay, this is beyond this application, and I want to kind of move on.
I didn't know who John Gillis was, and nor do I know who this gentleman is either.
He's the engineer for Mr.
Correct,
Gillis.
Yes.
And if I wanted to see the plan, I had to drive over to 1000 Main Street in Acton.
Not at all. There was.
That's what it says here on this. that I have here.
So
copies of notice of intent may be obtained from Sam Stan McNary by calling whatever during the hours of 8 a.m. to 4 p.m.
So correct. If you had called us, I would have been happy to send you a plan.
It wasn't much time.
You can also get one at Town Hall.
I was only served the notice on a Good Friday. And of course, Friday, that was Easter weekend. So Monday was the holiday, Paul Revere Day. So Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and of course, you're closed on Friday. And then this week, only Monday and Tuesday.
Jim,
and of course,
did you send out the legal notice too?
Holiday week, by the way. I sent out notices.
The legal notice says that you can pick up a plan at Town Hall.
That's not what it says here.
Well, that's not the legal notice. There was,
that's what I got.
There was
that's what I signed
butters notification.
Your butters notification. And the legal notice was in the
yes.
same packet.
Tells me I have to go to action to get it.
What's that one on the front? Read through that.
Meeting. Pursuant to Mass General, blah, 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 blah. Public meeting, Wednesday, April 26th.
Last line.
Location parcel. All work will be within 100 feet of boarding.
That's not the last line.
The application and plans can be viewed during regular business hours at Town Hall Conservation Office, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass. That's where we are now.
That's right.
Between the hours of 0700 and 1730 hours, 7 a.m. to 5:30 p.m.
Yeah.
And 3 days during vacation week for kids in school. So why was it sent out on Good Friday, knowing that the holiday week was the following week, which leaves only 2 days for somebody to review the plans? It seems to be put on a fast track for some reason, doesn't it?
No.
It's not under normal.
During a vacation week?
They don't count. It's just
a has to be to the town hall
a legal holiday.
Because they're open.
Yeah.
That's what it's the town hall doesn't follow school vacation.
Mm. No, I'm talking about the people who would be looking at the plans and coming to see you. They're
that's
on vacation with their children at school.
Well, it's open to the public. You can't.
It doesn't seem to be user-friendly for the public, the hours, and the notification. Isn't there at least 2-3 weeks before something like this is
no.
a monumental
these
project?
These notifications are required by law.
Right.
And
but is
the
there
fact
a timeliness
that
that's in law?
That's in the regulations, and they did follow that protocol.
So the regulation says you can deliver on Good Friday. Go over
it's a business
weekend.
Day.
That's right.
It's a business day.
But the following Monday wasn't. It was paper.
But that was after you received it. So that timeline doesn't.
I wasn't available.
Well, I can't control that, and neither can the applicant.
It seems to me there's a limited amount of time to review this monumental project.
Okay, you know what? This is going nowhere. So thank you very much for your input. But
okay, when will the next meeting be? Do you know?
It's in 2 weeks. On a Wednesday.
May 10th?
May 10th.
Will we get another written notification?
No, you have to keep up with the continuations after your first notification. But there's another way that you can do that. You can contact the clerk's office and ask for or sign up to receive all the agendas to any board that you want, planning board, conservation, whatever. And then every time they're submitted, you'll get an emailed copy of that.
The town clerk across the way you're talking about.
Yeah, town clerk.
One other question, if I may. The abutters who live next door and to the side, the water that now goes into the gully, what's going to happen to that?
They're not proposing to do any work.
So right now,
we don't
all
know
that's
what they're going to
is
do.
A line of where the wetland is.
Yeah.
And what happens after that?
It's information that gets passed on, that's all.
It goes into this property for 3 years that this line is where the wetland will be.
So there will be no building upon it?
We have no say over building.
Who has that say?
It's up to the applicant to submit plans.
Under our regulations.
Under our regulations.
And the applicant
not just
is this gentleman?
Whoever submits a permit is the applicant.
It would be
so
a completely different submittal process.
It is,
and you would
be
notified.
You would
similar
be notified.
To this.
I just want to know why all of a sudden after almost 67 years, this is coming up. It's just been lying there dormant for all these decades. What sparked it? Was it the drought last year?
Oh, see, if Al was here, he would answer this question.
Who's Al?
Al's on our commission,
Al
and
tell you that
yeah, he would. Yeah,
property
so
for 60 years.
The prices of land has gone up so high, every land, piece of land is buildable now. It's worth it to find something that you can put a house on.
Well, this would be good news for the people who live behind Bachelor Road, because there's 100 acres back there that could be buildable then. We could have a whole new development.
We just tell them to bring in a submittal.
But people don't know that unless they come to this meeting. I guess we'll have to spread the news ourselves then.
I know, we'll have to. Maybe they'll watch, this is recorded.
It's on the table, there's no, from now on, everything is on the table.
I don't know what you're talking about.
I'd love to hear what Carol has to say.
I just want to know, because I'm not an engineer and I don't understand.
Carol, your name and where you live.
I'm Carol Luciniak, I live 84 Bachelor Road. Is the line, that dotted line, is that where you're saying one side of that's wetlands and the other side?
Yeah, so.
All right, that's all I need.
So the green line?
This is the wetland line as.
All the left is wetlands.
Yes, yeah, so exactly what he said.
Yeah.
Yes, sir, your name and.
Yeah, I'm Mr. Maxwell.
Tyrone.
I'm on the west side of this property. 93 Bachelor Road. And over the last couple of years, of course, we've had the drought. We haven't had any water out there.
That's right.
But this year we do, because of all the wet and rain and snow and everything else that we've had since February. So there's a lot of water out there now. And that's been the case a lot of years. We've been there for 48 years in this house at 93 Bachelor Road. So I mean, it's just a matter of, there's a lot of water out beyond my property, plus goes into this, back to this property that we're talking about. So I mean, there's a lot of water out there right now.
Okay, thank you.
Just want to let everybody, I'm sure that once they were there Monday, I know there were several people out there Monday, I'm sure they saw the water.
We saw the water at the culvert, yes. And the wetland, we observed wetland plants, as well as hydric soils, which is what you use to define the location of the wetland, so.
I've had ducks waiting in my backyard.
Okay, you know what, we're gonna continue this.
If we continue this, ANRAD to May 10th.
May 10th.
Okay.
Second.
All those in favor? Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So this is May 10th is the next meeting for this?
Right, so put that on your calendars.
Becky, I'm sorry, do we need them out there for?
We need him and the wetland scientist when we are going back out for our second visit.
I think so.
It's up to the applicant.
Yeah.
Yeah. I would assume you'd want to have representation.
I would certainly like to be there, I don't expect anything to change. But, yeah, we'll discuss that.
Okay.
Should we try to do it in case there's anything, or they're trying to get us a new plan? Should we try to do it before our typical Monday site visit?
That would be helpful, it's been a very busy week. I'm sorry I wasn't able to get a plan to you sooner. So, a site walk that's, any time really would work for me. Could we do something, say, what's a Wednesday? Next Thursday, maybe?
You don't want it then. We need your information, we need the information before Wednesday of next week. So if you could submit the plan before then, so that's your deadline.
Oh, even sooner than that, that's fine.
Well, you've got the plan already, right?
Yes.
So.
It's just a site visit.
Yeah.
I'm available tomorrow, Monday, Tuesday.
I'm available tomorrow in the morning until 10. And then from noon on.
I could be tomorrow, Monday, Tuesday, I'm not sure.
I could be available on Monday.
I wouldn't be available until next week.
I'm sorry, what?
I would not be available until next week.
Oh, okay.
I'd like to be there.
Tuesday.
And I'd like to see if the delineator could be available as well.
I could do Monday, but not Tuesday.
I'm the same.
You can do Monday?
Monday, but not Tuesday.
Yeah, I can't do Tuesday.
Let's try for Monday. I've got things. No, I could do it in the morning.
Should I say tentatively?
At this point, Monday morning would be better for me.
Monday morning.
I
Is that the first?
Nine.
Oh, you know what? I might be able to do that.
Yeah.
Is nine doable?
I would. It might be.
Nine. Sounds good.
Sun's up at six.
Hey, 5 o'clock. Is nine okay?
I think it will be. I won't be able to let you know until tomorrow.
Okay.
And that's April 1st, too.
April 1st.
I mean, excuse me, May 1st.
May 1st.
Just to be clear, our next meeting here is on the 10th of May. Is that correct?
Correct.
Correct.
It starts at 7, but they might not be on exactly at 7, so you can go online and look at the agenda to see.
I enjoyed the album box.
Okay.
Thanks again.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Can I just ask who made the motion, Anika, and who seconded it?
Do we have a second? And we have all in favor.
I don't want to give it to anybody else. Okay,
next on the agenda is tree policy 68 Sanborn Lane, map 34, lot 36, Braybeck. Folks, we still have Boar on our agenda. Thank you.
We'll need the new plan for
you. Might as well wait until Monday.
Okay. Thanks.
I'm not forecasting anything. I'm just, it makes more sense to save some paper.
Okay, Mr. Brevet.
So I have several trees that I'm concerned about the safety of our dwelling as well as the trees in my yard. We border the conservation land on several sides. And the trees in question are numbered here. Several of them are large trees. I've submitted photos. The biggest concern I have is the degree to which they are either leaning towards the house, proximity of the house, or have the, you know, the Y fork split of the trees that could cause a large limb to fall. So that's the extent of it, and we had several tree companies come out and take a look. We had someone come out and look at what he perceived as the safety or not of the trees and made their recommendations.
I think it says six, just for but I think it counts out seven.
I'm sorry.
It
counts out
eight.
Oh, it's eight.
Yeah.
As Dave and I came to almost
blows.
Actually, is it's it actually comes out to eight. You have in your letter seven, and the tree person actually has. And then he says all of the issues state in regards to the six trees. So he has seven trees numbered, and then it's six trees in the text. You have seven, and you actually have eight marked with the X. And the ones that are here, I believe it's the one that's marked with a five, is the second large red oak. And then where you have four, there's another one that's closer to the backyard that is another white pine.
Mm-hmm.
So, but anyway.
Chuck, I don't know if you received that email that I sent.
I do. We can go through each tree.
Could I just ask, is that the dark line, is that your property line, or is that
No, that says
stream.
This
stream.
Black line is the topo line. It's just, it shows
major contour line.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay. And the yellow is the property line, I see. Okay.
And this 2 feet intervals. All right, so we'll go to the pictures now.
So this is the front of the house, and I guess this is my southwest corner, southeast corner, sorry. The red oak on the left is a large tree that is leaning towards our house there, and it's about 20 feet from the house there itself. The red maple on the left is also one in fairly close proximity to that same tree there. So again, in close proximity to the house. And also along that corner of the house are where the power lines come in as well.
I thought the white pine in the front, the power lines are really close to that. They're like right
almost in the branches. That's
the
third tree in the front. And that's actually one of that I have most concerns about because of the lean towards the house, proximity to the house, the power lines and all.
That little one between the white pine and the red oak, was it, that was a smaller one, and that was the one that had the
had
hole
the,
down
exactly
there?
Exactly right, the rot in the hole in the at the base. These are on the rear of the house. These are large trees. There's a lot of what has become deadfall that comes down in large limbs. Now, I don't remember if I pointed out to you, I don't think I did, that, you know, we've got a big limb that's kind of sitting.
We saw that one.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's where the kids are, you know, they're playing around. So we have a lot of concern with that. These trees, these pictures don't show the proximity to the house, but given the size of these trees, they're clearly within striking distance. These show them a little bit better to the proximity. This one to the right, this is the pine you're talking about, photo on the right. This is actually at the front of the house.
You can actually see the power lines right there.
Exactly.
Coming out the other side of that.
The heavy leaning red oak to the rear, that was pretty self-evident. White pine in the rear, again leaning towards the house. And I honestly can't, obviously I took these pictures myself, and I can't honestly say why I didn't include the red maple that we had.
The multi-trunked red maple?
No, the multi-trunk I have in here somewhere. But it was the one that was sort of leaning over, not quite as heavily. This is the multi-trunk one here, this red maple here.
Okay, yeah.
I do have the red oak in the rear. This is one that I was talking about. And this is actually the photo, Chuck, that I sent, an additional photo that I sent to you, I think, today. But this one, this red oak on the right here is the one that has the split. You can't quite see it as evident here with the two large limbs.
That's the front.
Oh, this was the front. Yeah, that was the front with the hole in the hole.
All right. Did we do a site visit?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
We did see an additional tree with an X on it. Mm-hmm. Dave and I got into a fight over
the number. It was just that the number on this, the letter, and then the other one, it just didn't.
It's a very uncomfortable few minutes, I'll tell you. Not worth the fight, people.
In a fight between these two, I'm betting on Dave, I'm sorry.
I don't know, it's the fight and the dog.
It was four circles in the back of the house, but there was five trees.
And we both agreed, but we weren't agreeing. It was the strangest conversation.
If I could just begin on this here, you know, according to our tree policy, we have a letter from an arborist that observed these trees and recommended that they be taken down, you know, for the safety and protection of the property. So according to our tree policy, I don't have a problem with taking the trees down, you know, for a number of reasons. I actually viewed the two pine trees that are in the back of your house. I looked at which way they lean. You know, I read the, when I say I read the trunks of the tree, I have experience cutting trees. I'm not an arborist, but I do have a lot of experience cutting trees. And those trees are definitely, the weight of the trees and the heavy limbs of the trees are facing just about mid-deck. And the one that's closest to your house and the one that's behind that is probably about 4 feet to the left of the deck. You know, either with the, if they come down, they're tall enough to actually reach probably the peak of your roof, which would do substantial damage, but.
I have two quick questions. One, Chuck, one for you, I guess. Iron Tree Service, have we seen them around? Just out of curiosity, more for my information.
I have not ever heard from Iron Tree Service before to this.
You're out of Beverly.
Beverly, yeah.
And then with our tree policy, we have a replacement requirement. What was there?
So if it's a hazardous tree,
yep.
It does not need to be replaced.
Okay.
So the site visit was to determine, you know, if they're hazard trees or if they're just trees that are coming down because it's an uncomfortable situation.
Okay.
So that's what we're doing.
All
right. The other thing with this is that, as Mr. Brabeck had said to us, there's a low or no impact that's going to happen with this. Is they're going to actually have a crane come in and set the crane up in the driveway and boom the crane over the house. So there's going to be no.
The arborist was there when.
Pardon?
The arborist was there when you.
No.
That's
what Mr. Brabeck told us.
Okay.
That was the methodology that they were going to use to take these trees down. Is that we're going to set up a crane in the driveway and boom the crane over the house, cut the trees, and then lift them over the house, which is pretty common.
I thought the trees in the front were definitely leaning towards, except the little one, but it is compromised root system. Definitely 7'6". I'm not sure about 8 and 4. Those are those huge pine trees next to the zip line. It's got a nice zip line back. I just don't know about those. They seem far away. Maybe they would fall on the house. There was a widowmaker in one of them, I think the closest one.
Are either of those two on this?
Yes, well, they're on that.
Well, I know, but there was a disagreement of the 8 trees versus 6 trees.
We've got them all on this plan.
They're all on there. The one that really wasn't was the, that was actually noted here, was the other red oak that had the Y crutch, which is another weakness in a tree. That one wasn't on this letter from the arborist.
What number is that up there?
It would be 5.
So you're thinking there's 2 pine trees that are least dangerous? Are they, if you take everything out around them, are they swinging in the breeze all by themselves, or are they still near other trees?
There's a tree, there's the big pine where the zip line is right to the south of number 4. So there's one right next to it. Kind of like boom, boom, right in a row. The huge, huge pines.
When I used to actually have pines like that in my backyard.
And then you cut them down?
Yep, I did. After every thunderstorm, I used to go out and pick up these limbs that were like this, that were in my yard. 2 of them in different storms actually came down and pierced my shed roof. And I had 4 or 5 feet of this giant limb that was right through the roof of my shed. And I used to think every time I would go out and pick up these limbs, it's, how is there no limbs on these trees anymore? Because of the number, I just, you know, seems like I picked up dozens of limbs, but they do calve off limbs from time to time, especially with heavy wet snow or thunder showers in the summer. But
exactly what you're talking about.
What's that?
I pulled those out of my yard many times.
The thing about pine trees, I've read, I'm not an arborist, so I won't swear to this, is the reason why they grow these leaders, they call them, is because insects get on the top of the tree and it creates a situation where the original trunk actually splits. And one grows off in one direction, the other, and it's actually a weakness in the tree. Mm-hmm. So,
but you know, like I said, I read the lean of those trees, and they're both actually heavily. The weight of the trees is towards the house side of the tree, and the lean of the house is towards the house side of the tree in those large pine trees. So.
We've got a letter from an arborist.
A letter from the arborist.
Seems to think they're concerned. Any other thoughts?
Any thoughts, Chuck?
Yeah, well, my thought is they all don't qualify for no tree replacement. So I think 4 and 5.
Say that again.
8, 4, and 5. Okay. Out of the 8 trees, I was okay with all of them coming down. But I didn't think that, because, you know, when someone gets worried about their trees, you know, what are you going to do? That's not our job. But do every single one of those trees that are going to get cut down, should they be replaced or not? And I thought at least 3 needed to be replaced.
You're thinking four, five, and eight.
Yeah.
I would actually agree with that.
I'm just asking for first day I can do anything, right?
Get away with it.
When trees are replaced like this, do they have to be replaced within a certain distance of the old tree, or they can be replaced anywhere on the property?
Anywhere in the buffer zone.
And they don't have to be that size.
Doesn't have to be the same species of tree either, no?
No, they have to be native, and it can be anywhere in the buffer zone. And, you know, that's possible, yeah, with this site, I think.
Do you have any issues with replacement for 3 of them?
Okay. I move we approve this, as discussed.
This is a...
May I just ask a clarifying question, though? The tree policy. What does it, I mean, I know in concept what it means, but what does it mean to actually replace the tree? Is it with a sapling? Is it with a...
Sapling.
No, it's not sapling.
So it's...
Yeah.
3-inch caliper.
It's 3-inch caliper.
No, I understand that, but if we look, that's what a sapling is. A tree is, I think, 6 inches. Yeah, so it really is called a sapling.
Oh.
Bill Manuel could tell us.
Well, we weren't doing that in my last meeting in another spot. The sapling was like 1 inch and a certain height, because they were talking about taking out all the saplings, and that same discussion happened with DCR. So we'll look into it. But yeah, we asked for a 3-inch caliper, so you know, something like that. 8 to 12. It's in the tree policy. If you don't have it, I can email it to you. But it's not a very big tree, but it is tall. You know,
you can also do some shrubs, right?
And usually the shrubs are 2 shrubs for each tree. The certain shrubs can be 1 for 1, but that's also in the tree policy. We have a chart to follow.
Okay.
All the tree replacements need to be native.
Okay.
And Chuck,
we have that also, and can send that to you if needed. You really need to plant. You can really plant the tree anytime up until like. Don't do it in July.
Okay. Don't do it until after.
Don't do it until after.
Just in case.
I'll ask you to call. So I'll send you kind of a summary of what happened here and our approval. And I'll also email you those 2 things I talked about, the tree policy and the native plant list. and then ask you to let me know when the new trees are planted. And the one question we didn't ask, are you intending to remove the stumps or just grind them? Because that might be another consideration the commission wants to understand.
The only stumps that we would grind is number 7.
But you're not intending to remove any stumps, so you won't be digging in the ground and pulling anything
out? We're going to cut them low to the, we'd like to cut them low to the ground.
Flush, yeah.
But 7 is the only one that we want to grind.
Okay, so stumping and grinding is fine. It's just when you're going to excavate, that would be a question we would need to know about. So that's great.
Okay. Chuck, so, just out of curiosity, it just says under tree policy.
Doesn't that say it's a minor permit?
Is that a minor?
Well, the tree policy has taken over some of the minor project permits because we did not want to charge someone who has to go out and buy a tree.
Okay.
So we don't do a minor project permit. We do a tree policy, you know, when it works, like this.
Okay.
So there's no permit.
Motion only to approve.
It's just approved, yeah. Under the tree policy. Yeah, so yeah, that's what how it will be decided. Spend your money on a tree.
I'll second.
Anika.
All those in favor?
So you can look at the website, that's helpful. You can ask Chuck, you know, to help you like pick species and things like that. He might be able to give you suggestions.
Okay.
But you know who you really have to ask.
I'm away.
Yeah.
Or you can beg for forgiveness.
Mike,
thank you very much.
Made the motion.
Thank you. Good luck.
So I think I scared off Al, Mr. Couillard, by putting him on the
I saw that.
The agenda that was annotated.
Oh, that was the new one.
Yeah, because I wanted him, because we both went to Perfecto's, which is 285 Main Street, and you know, Perfecto's is, we're hearing a lot, all the departments are hearing about Perfecto's getting ready to, you know, do their final stuff, electrical, plumbing, building, conservation. And when we were out there, they needed a lot of work, and they needed someone to help them with the work. And we let the engineers that were there know that we were unhappy with a riprap at the back of the building, which is not really riprap, it's beach stones. They're round. They're round on a slope.
Where do you even get, it's like, you get those from like,
from
the beach.
In the bag.
Yeah.
But it's clearly not professionally done. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he owns that back half. It's about 2 feet, and it's eroding, and they've put the core logs in there. And a lot of it's good, but the last 20 feet has to be redone again. And then it needs to be added to. But we didn't want to design it while we were out there. And we told the engineer, I haven't talked to the owner, but I told the engineer that this needs to be addressed before they could open up this store. So it was that, and we picked out the spots where the granite bounds are going to go, and we talked about the planting plan. It seems like they'll do the planting plan as per planned on the plan. And the only outstanding unknown is how the bank is going to be stabilized and who's going to get into that work.
I thought that's what the core logs were for. Is that a different problem?
Well, the undercutting of the bank, the core logs will help, and it was about 80 feet that they did, and for 60 feet of it, it's probably fine. Two problems though. The last 20 feet needs to be redone, tucked in better, and staked in. It needs to be staked in.
Farthest from the road?
Yes.
Okay.
Heading back.
Here's to the corner of the building that's close to
where the planting, where all the planting's going to go, so where most of the parking area is. Or if you're looking at it to the right-hand side.
How long has this been going on?
I could only hazard a guess.
Call Jamie to ask.
5 years?
Wow.
It took place burned about 15 years ago.
How do you keep a construction project going on for 5 years?
And then
years?
The second issue is the riprap area. So
this is crazy.
So is that also at the parking lot behind the building?
It's absolutely directly behind the building.
Okay.
It's only about 2 feet of bank between the foundation of the building and the stream.
Now when I went, I walked through back there, and I don't remember it being any beach stones. So I remember it being that orange construction fence holding the riprap from falling into the stream. So they must have added it.
Yeah, there was that there, too.
Is that still there?
Yes, it was.
Okay.
We told them it's got to get fixed up.
So Al told you...
I was with you that day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was you, me, and Al, I think.
No,
I remember that.
He's got a thing for that.
The back corner was even closer to the stream,
not a
2 feet.
It's just that, like I said, it was just the last 20 feet, and we just, you know, clearly the people that were working there wanted to know what we thought about what would it take to clean this up, and we let them know.
Good.
So.
Does this certificate of compliance, that's what they're looking for, right?
They haven't asked for it yet.
But are we in a position of holding up their certificate of occupancy, or do they already have
that? Well, I already let everybody know in town hall we're not signing off until the bank is fixed.
Right.
Because it's such a huge issue.
So the answer
and
is yes.
With the speed of construction, if we let them, you know, it just has to be done. I think, we have his attention if we don't issue the occupancy.
We have a bond for this project?
Yes.
But again, it probably doesn't cover this work.
No, it would cover erosion for sure.
Okay. Well,
Chuck, did the white pipe?
But I don't think that's. They're just doing it in phases. You know, get the inside done, get the parking lot done. If you've driven past in the last couple of weeks, you've noticed that they clear cut all the old vegetation, and they're going to start to rebuild that. Going to take out the erosion control. I think it's on their list. I just, at every opportunity, want to tell every department that, you know, this is not going to work in any other way, but we all get our sign-offs at the same time, and then we can issue the occupancy.
Yeah. Okay.
Chuck, did the white pines that are in the back of that building, did they survive?
In the back of that building?
Yeah.
I didn't... the white pines, that the newly planted ones?
Oh, that were there last year, yeah.
The newly planted ones, there's a couple dead shrubs back there. I don't even know if those shrubs are on the planting plan, and some of the things that had happened in the past were they just decided to plant stuff, and I told them, we got to go by the plan. So if they're not on the plan, it doesn't matter if they're dead.
Do we have anything else on the agenda?
Certificate of compliance at Artist, that's being continued.
Yeah. Well, so I gave an update on that. I sent a list. So does anyone remember the blowout of the corner of the pond at Artist Senior Living?
Right.
And that was an issue that happened right away, and then it was this big mystery. No one could figure it out. Because we're not there during the day when they're supposed to be doing their investigation. So time went on. This erosion that took out a whole bunch of the bank never happened again. So they closed it up, rebuilt the bank, and called it a day. So the neighborhood across the street is getting their culverts being backed up, and it's flooding. And I was talking to Ryan about this, and they need to investigate to find out if that culvert has been blocked. And so that went on our list for Hayes to do. And the granite bounds are on our list, and to the signage on the granite bounds, and the vegetation that needs to be done.
And the wetland elevation?
And the connectivity between the two wetlands was on the list.
Okay.
Anything else?
Moving the stone bound near the crabapple tree.
I didn't write that. No, moving the stone bound.
Yeah, that's the one by the snow pile.
Snow pile, the snow fence.
Correct.
Was it too close to the wetland?
Too close to the wetland, yeah.
I'll add it to the list. They didn't even get back to us, but we're working in conjunction with the engineering department to solve that flooding problem. So it should be quickly resolved.
Send one of them in the culvert. They can find their way out.
Administrator's report.
I don't have one prepared. I handed it off to Al, but I took it back.
We just talked about it.
Can I interject? I think we need to approve a minor plan change for Low Meadow. In your email.
Oh, yeah. No, that'll be presented.
Okay.
That'll be a real process.
Who's presenting it? The applicant?
Norris Environmental will come in and show us what he's going to do, put it on a plan,
That's the recommendation from Mike Abel.
So Mike told us at the site visit that he was going to issue a superseding order, but then he just emailed everyone and said, sorry, I didn't get back to you. So I'm a little confused, and I'm waiting for a superseding order to arrive, but maybe not.
Did the Conservation Commission give any follow-up letter or memo to DEP to CC him and his supervisor about the points that we made at the, just to sort of...
At Low Meadow?
No, I'm thinking more Roma Lane than...
No.
Sorry, I jumped to another side.
Mike had a conversation with him. Maybe Mike just wants to fill us in.
I talked with him at Low Meadow about it and just brought up the aspects that we had talked about. And he had indicated to me that his understanding was, even though we had told him multiple times, that his understanding was, we thought the line was at the one location, and they thought it was at, you know, the different.
Bill Manuel's.
So,
right.
Yeah, Bill Manuel's
right.
Line. And I made clear to him that no, that the whole reason this came up was, as it was brought to our attention, it was this one location or nothing. And so he said he had scheduled the site visit. He wanted to still follow through with that, but he was going to relook at our decision and what that entailed.
Is that meeting May 9th?
Yeah.
Yeah, at 10.
At 10 o'clock.
I think it wouldn't, it's not going to hurt to go out there again for us.
I just think having a clear written brief memo, sort of an executive summary of our decisions, our basic conclusion based on the evidence we had at the hearing, and how we supported it in our denial of their ANRAD. You know, because he said something odd to me at the meeting that I'd called Chuck afterwards because I was confused. I said, you know, this DEP guy, he told me that that there wasn't a vehicle, a way in the regulations to deny an ANRAD based on insufficient data. And I was like, really? And then I went back and I looked up Wetland Form 4A or 4B or something like that from DEP. And there's this lovely checkbox
that says
we are denying this ANRAD due to insufficient information. You know, I just think, you know, they work off of paper copies. And conversations can be sometimes not remembered correctly or just kind of clouded. So...
What do our minutes say? Shouldn't that be the record that we share?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
well, I mean,
I'm just thinking reiterating our point.
Yeah,
I don't want to see us lose.
We could take out, we have two bullets from the denial, in essence, that says, you know, for these reasons, it's insufficient information and
inconclusive information.
Yeah.
And CC him and his superior, who he talks to.
I think ultimately, well,
just a quick state our case kind of memo.
I mean, I'd be interested to see, because this was, again, I talked to him at Low Meadow, and I was expecting more, just like you were, from Low Meadow than an email that, like, that's how they resolve appeals? Is it an email to the commission? It seems... odd. and incomplete. That's how an appeal would, if I were the person appealing, I would want to see more than an email as a decision from the.
Right. What, and how does that work? If the residents appeal Norris's or that property owner's permit, DEP has to come back with an official response to appeal.
Right.
And then the applicant has to respond to DEP's correspondence regarding their property.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Even though I'm sure,
yeah,
you know, the responsibility was on the residents for even bringing up the appeal, but they're not responsible for bringing that permit back before us and addressing the issues. So
I think we need something clear.
I'm new here, but.
But I think to
DEP.
Need something clear from the DEP that says appeal is granted or denied, or denied, but I'm applying additional conditions, right? I mean, those are the
right.
Three.
Who is it at DEP? It's Heidi Davis, right?
It's one of the people, yeah.
I think he keeps on mentioning Heidi Davis.
I was just thinking about it. You know, I mean, if they're, if DEP has a, this guy has a huge caseload, and he spent plenty of time talking to the residents, and getting their ear and talking to them. And just especially at Roma, he didn't seem to verify what I thought DEP should have verified, just procedurally. Like, okay,
well, he's not done yet, but I'm thinking.
He's also a wildlife biologist, okay?
So, but I understand.
And a super great white hunt. Was it a great white hunter? What is he trying to be there?
So,
he's got two things going.
Botswana.
He's got the hunts.
Botswana.
Yeah.
Jack Hanna.
Jack Hanna. He's a Jack Hanna groupie.
I just think in the paperwork world, one brief letter sent to everybody that says we're just going to restate our points simply.
I think you should call Heidi Davis. I don't think anything would be better than that. 20 minutes on the phone.
Well, he's got to either deny or approve the denial.
No,
yeah,
they're gonna.
I mean, that's.
That's
what no,
I said
to him.
Is like, are you? You guys aren't in the business of redoing lines.
He seemed to indicate he was.
I know.
Yeah,
right?
I know.
He indicated. He said. You know. I said it isn't. You know, the whole point was there's not enough conclusive information.
He did
for
say
a line.
Something around that when he was talking about digging the pits.
Yeah, he indicated out there that he would.
Yeah.
That
he's
ready
and that's
to
what
draw
I come
that
from
line.
Meadow,
yeah.
You guys really in the business of redoing lines,
right.
I think we're gonna have his ear again out there. I think that
something seems missing with Low Meadow, like a denial of the appeal.
Oh yeah,
and appeal with conditions, additional
right.
conditions from the applicant.
But I don't know
at 44
what
Roma,
we're to do that.
At 44
right?
Roma, we were talking about the getting the appeal in exactly on the 19th day or whatever the thing is, and he's sending an email back as like his decision.
An official thing, like all of our permits.
But an email is an official record. It's not. It may not be the DEP's form letter.
But it's still got to adjudicate and make a decision.
Right.
Yeah.
It still has to
no
say approved or denied.
So it's like, you know.
How do you
they're,
appeal with no
they're
answer?
They're running around, taking classes, you know, doing this wetland stuff, and like we're all drinking the Kool-Aid, and then all of a sudden we need them to back us up, and it's
right.
not what they do. And the first time it happens to you guys, you're going to be wicked surprised, but that's just how it goes. They only want to be fair, both sides. So.
Well, I think fair is a good thing.
Fair is fine, yeah. I don't understand the process either, and I just think, you know, he's just not doing any. He'll say one thing and then do something else. So what does it matter if we? But a call to Heidi Davis or whoever the section chief is, or a meeting, it would be interesting. You know, that's what you do best there, Anika.
All right.
I would.
Anybody,
can I get a vote to have
anybody?
Anika
going to have.
Take the helm.
Have any objections?
I have no objection.
Advice?
Just remember, this is,
you
zoomed in the microscope down on one lot. We're not going to lose the fight for one lot.
Can I make a motion to adjourn?
Please.
I'm still lost between denying or denial. Isn't that an approval?
Negative.
Might work that way.
Double negative.
Two negatives and positive, right?
Yeah.
Wait a second.
I'll second.
Meeting adjourned. Thank you, everyone.